Can somebody say amen? God bless you. You can be seated. Perhaps you can remember way back to your elementary school science class, whatever grade it may have been, kindergarten, first grade, second grade, whatever, where everybody built a papier-mâché volcano out of the daily newspaper and then filled it with two specific ingredients used to cause a reaction and an eruption. Does anybody know what those two ingredients are? Don't everybody say it at once. Baking soda and vinegar. What is that? Sodium bicarbonate and acetic acid, is that right? I'm not Bill Nye here, but thank you. See, my memory is just that good, all the way back to first grade. Here you have these two elements. One is your primary substance. It's basic, I think, as they say in science. It's your baking soda, your sodium bicarbonate. And then you have what is called the catalyst. And this is the vinegar, the acetic acid. And they come together to make magic. At least that's what I thought in school. Now, to define the word catalyst for you, a catalyst is simply a substance that enables a chemical reaction to proceed at a usually faster rate or under different conditions than otherwise possible. Now, again, I'm no science expert, but in this science experiment, when the two substances come together, they mingle and mix, it causes a reaction with the byproducts being two things, carbon dioxide and water, CO2 and H2O. And the releasing of this carbon dioxide is what creates the bubbles and ultimately the eruption and the smiles all across the classroom. Now let's use this simple, familiar experiment to understand a principle. It is the coming together of these two individual elements that creates the reaction. By themselves, they do nothing. Baking soda by itself is just baking soda. It sits in that little orange box. It keeps your refrigerator fresh, but it's just baking soda. And vinegar, which is the catalyst, by itself is just vinegar. Only when the two elements come together is the power of the catalyst realized and a reaction takes place. Now, that's very simplistic, but tonight I want to talk a little bit about faith. And just like that acetic acid, that vinegar, faith is a catalyst in our walk with God. When faith comes in contact with other elements in our walk with the Lord, it unlocks the supernatural to flow into our lives, and it unlocks miraculous demonstration to take place. It is faith that elevates us from human ability to God's ability. And so I declare something that we all know and we would likely agree upon, but we must have faith. If we're going to do this thing right and if we're going to be effective, we've got to have the catalyst of faith in our lives. Faith is the active ingredient that brings everything we do as people of God to life. If we bow our knee to pray, but we do it without faith, faith that God hears and faith that God will answer, then our prayers are empty and we're just filling time. If we come to service but we don't have faith for a miraculous demonstration and for lives to be transformed by the power of the gospel, then it is merely an exercise in religious ritual. If we witness to a sinner, a coworker, or a classmate, but we don't have faith that God can use our testimony to bring an increase in their life, then we are wasting our breath, because faith is the catalyst. Faith is that active ingredient that makes it all work. Even something as anointed and powerful as God's word, it doesn't work unless it's combined with faith. The writer of Hebrews in chapter 4, verse 2, he said, "For unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them. But the word preach did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it." You see, there's two groups of people shown in this verse. One received the word and they had faith, that catalyst to go along with the word. And it brought about a reaction, a transformation in their life. But the other group just had the word and no faith. They didn't mix the word with faith. And I know that the word is anointed and I know the word is inspired, but the word didn't profit them anything because they didn't have faith. We can come to church Sunday after Sunday and we can hear sermon after sermon and have all kinds of word. But if we don't mix the word with faith, it will profit us nothing. If we read, study, and hear the word of God preached, but we don't have faith in its power, then it's little more than learning theology and historical events. You see, faith is a catalyst. Faith is an active ingredient that when we neglect to use it, everything we do is in vain. Now, it is Pastor Appreciation Month, and this afternoon, I baked a loaf of bread for Pastor Jack. And he's going to toss that up to me. It is for you. I'll give it back. You're welcome. It looks a little abnormal. You know, if you like bread, how it tastes about 2 to 3 weeks after, you know, left on the counter outside of the bag, you would love this. You see, I got everything in there. I got the flour, and I got the salt, and I got the water, and I got whatever else goes in bread. Put it in the bread machine, turned it on, but I forgot the yeast. This is still a little bit warm. Made this afternoon. I forgot the active ingredient. And you see, I'm well-intentioned, and I'm well-meaning, and I really appreciate my pastor, But I did it in vain because nobody in their right mind is going to eat this. You can give it to my mother. She'll throw it out to the birds and everybody will be happy except my father. But that's okay. Somebody say the active ingredient. Appreciate you, Pastor. We're going to have a round of softball after service. Found the ball. But faith is that catalyst. Faith is that active ingredient. And when we don't have faith, we don't have anything. The writer of Hebrews went so far as to say that without faith, it is impossible to please the God that we serve. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Evidently, God gets a little offended when we try to serve him without believing in his power, in his ability, in his might, in his strength. God said, if you don't have faith, you can't even begin to try to please me. We need a rebaptism of faith in the apostolic church in the 21st century because faith is what makes all of this come to life. Somebody say faith. And I know sometimes our faith can deplete a bit. I know sometimes life and circumstances can shake our faith and doubt can creep in. But in spite of everything we go through, there's one thing we can't afford to lose. And that is our faith in the ability of Jesus Christ to change a life and to heal a body and to pick somebody up and to turn somebody around. We must have faith. It's something worth fighting for. In fact, Jude tells us in Jude 1 and 3 that we must earnestly contend for the faith. This isn't something that we can passively engage in and just expect everything to just maintain itself. We got to contend for our faith sometimes. Paul told Timothy, I want you to fight the good fight of faith. And at the end of his life, Paul tells us in 2 Timothy 4 and 7 that he fought that good fight. And in spite of imprisonment and in spite of persecution and in spite of physical challenges, Paul said, at the end of this fight and at the end of my life, I've kept my faith because it's just something I couldn't afford to go through life without. You see, I know it's easy sometimes for our faith to leak and we can end up just going through the motions. But I've come to remind CCC today and to somebody in this room that there's something we need to fight for. There's something we need to contend for. There's something that we need to stir up on the inside of us. And that is our faith in what God can do in a life. Faith in what God can do in a community like Marysville. Faith in what God can do in a city like Fredericton. Faith in what God can do in a province like PEI. We need to have faith in this time. Come on, clap your hands unto the Lord for a moment. Give God a shout of praise if you've got faith. Come on, we've got to have faith in God to believe Him that anything can happen in a moment just like this one, in a service just like this one. Anything is possible if we have faith. I've come to remind somebody that God can and God still will do anything. And it's our faith that gives us access to this ability. Matthew 21:22, Jesus said, in all things. Now, I know we make this joke often, so I'm not even going to go there, but all means all. You look it up in the Greek, right? All means all. And Jesus said all things, which means that that wayward son or daughter fits in this category. Means that that husband or wife that is cold and indifferent to the things of God fits in this category. It means that that club that we're starting at our high school is trying to reach into sinners and people that don't know the Lord fits in this category. Whatever you can think of, Jesus said all things, and everything fits in the category of all things. And so I don't know what need you've come into this room with tonight, but I've come to tell you it fits in Jesus' category. And He said, all things whatsoever ye shall ask in prayer, comma, believing, comma, ye shall receive. Now, we focus a lot on the prayer part, and prayer is important. I'm not going to belittle the importance of it. I don't need to qualify. But we can't forget ingredient number two in this formula that Jesus gives us. He said, pray, believing, and then you shall receive. You see, I wonder how often we pray prayers that we really don't believe that God can step in and intervene. I wonder if we sometimes just kind of go through the motions on a Sunday evening or a Sunday morning because it's prayer time. We've sung two songs and you know, the service MC, the pastor gets up and he says, we're going to go to God in prayer. We just kind of go through it because we always do. You see, faith is that catalyst that when we incorporate with our prayer, when we incorporate with spiritual disciplines and obedience to His word and whatever else we do for God, when we add faith, it brings it to life and God can step in and move. If you can believe it, you can receive it because nothing is too hard for God. He said, all things whatsoever you shall ask in prayer, believing, ye shall receive. Faith is the key. Faith is the key. I think we need in the apostolic movement, and I know sometimes in my own life, I need a reminder of what God can do. I need a reminder, a bold declaration of truth, of the ability of God, so that my faith can be increased. And so I just want to direct our attention for a moment to a familiar verse of Scripture, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. We quote it often, but the Apostle Paul, he said, now unto Him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or we think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto Him be glory in the church, etc., etc. Now, if we could, just go back to verse 20 for a second. I wonder if we can try to grasp the incredible greatness of this statement. Now, I'm in a room of apostolics, as far as I'm aware. And you know, you say some things in an apostolic service, in an apostolic church, and it ought to get a reaction. And so if you're apostolic, I wonder if you can help me in the next few minutes. If I were to make the statement, now unto Him that is able, and I've got some slides at the back. Now unto Him that is able. If I were to say God is able, what kind of a reaction would that get out of the church today? I thought you guys were apostolic. I thought you guys were believers and you had faith. Well, if I said God is able, what kind of a reaction does that get out of the people of God? Okay, I've got some people that still believe that God is able. But you see, Paul didn't just say that God is able. Paul said that now unto Him that is able to do all. Now, okay, if God is able, that's great, but If God is able to do all, again, everything fits in the category of all. And so I'm going to make a statement here tonight, and I wonder if you believe it, if you can help me, that God is able to do all things. Come on, nothing is too hard for the God that we serve. Your family situation is not too far beyond the reach of the God that we serve. God is able to do all things. But the Apostle Paul didn't just say that God is able to do all. The Apostle Paul said God is able to do above all. Now, I don't even know how you go above all, but God can do it. So I'm just going to make a statement here tonight. God is able to do above all. And I'm thankful for that. And I'm glad you are too. But as we know, the Apostle Paul, he said that God is not only able, and not only is God able to do all or above all, but God is able to do abundantly above all. And as if that wasn't enough, Paul was just racking his brain. How can I express the greatness and the ability of the God that we serve? And he just finally put it to paper and he said, God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all. I wonder if there's any believers in the house that know that God is not just able, but God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all things. There is nothing that's too hard for the God that we serve. There is no demographic that God can't reach into, multicultural team. There's no student that God can't reach down into and touch, high school students. But Paul was not done, because he said all of this is above what we could ask or even think. At the bottom of the totem pole, you've got your human ability to achieve an expected end. But Paul said it's not just human ability. We can go into the realm of prayer and asking God, but then we can step into the a greater realm of thinking and imagination and just almost our dreams of what God can do. And Paul said, my statement about God being exceedingly, abundantly, above all able, that doesn't even start until we get to the extent of your greatest imagination. The deepest dream that you have in your life, and the thing that you, if it happened just now, if that wayward son or daughter were to walk down this aisle and raise their hands and begin to repent and give their life to God again, if that were to happen now, you might say that that's just, I couldn't even hardly believe that. And Paul said the greatness of our God, it begins at that point. And it's exceeding abundantly above all those things at that point. And so one last time, I'm going to just repeat the words of Paul. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ask or even think, according to the power that worketh in us. And he stops the statement by saying, unto him be glory. I wonder if we can give God some glory right now. And thank him for all that he can do. Come on, is there anybody that has faith that God can do anything? Just stay right there. This is not merely a doctrinal statement. This is not merely theology about God's ability, but it is a challenge to all of us as people of God to loose our faith and elevate our prayer, because nothing evidently is too hard for the God that we serve. You see, we often pray prayers and we pray them right around the bottom. And we say, you know, I could almost manage this, but I'm going to ask God to just do a little bit above that. And all the while, there is such bounty in the ability of God. There is a challenge in the spirit in this room tonight. If you have an impossible situation, the Holy Ghost has come into this room to remind you that there is nothing beyond the reach of the God that you serve. And if it's impossible to you, if you can imagine a resolution to the situation, Paul said, well, that's where God's ability just begins, and it only goes up from there. I wonder if you have an impossibility in your life. Stand to your feet for a moment, and I wonder if you can get it at the forefront of your mind. I believe that God wants to minister in this moment right here. This is the God elder that you've been serving for a few decades, perhaps. He's the God that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that you can ask or even think. Maybe they've been away from God for a few decades, but God is still able. Come on, God wants you to have faith. It's the catalyst that makes your faithfulness come to life. It's the catalyst that makes your prayer life come to life. With that impossible situation at the forefront of your mind, I wonder if you can lift up your voice with revelation of God's ability. And I wonder if you can just reach to God for a minute. Hira mandale lebo shorra bariesa, le la basharra mondo yele la basa. Some of us have just accepted the result as it is. And God is saying, don't you just accept what the enemy has declared over your family. Don't accept what the enemy's declared over your life. Believe me for something greater. Loose your faith one more time and believe in my ability. Hira basata la la mondo rebaesha le ramando yela la basanda yela base ho la baesha. I wonder if there's somebody in this room that would take a step of faith and step into an aisle for a minute. And believers, if you're in the room, gather around them, lay hands on them, because the Bible says that believers can lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. The Spirit of God is in this room in this moment. If you have a need that is impossible to you, as a step of faith, can you step into an aisle for a moment? And we're going to pray over you, and we're going to loose the exceeding abundantly above all power of God to work in your life. Sometimes it takes a little bit of boldness to step out. If you're sick in your body, if you've got a family member that's away from God, if you've got a husband or wife that's cold and indifferent, if you've got a son or a daughter that's backslidden and wayward, I wonder if you can step in the aisle on behalf of them. Don't accept the report of the enemy. Church family, can we make our way around these that have stepped out? And can we pray big prayers? Because we serve a big God that is able. Ryan, I just received a check in my spirit. I believe that God is going to heal that peanut allergy in Jesus' name. Why not believe God for it? Why just accept what the doctor has said? Why just accept the hand that life has dealt us? Come on, my God is able. My God is able. Halalabosoto yeramanda yelabasha. Ela ramondo yelabasana yeraboshoye. If you're done praying with one, just find your way to somebody else. Lay your hands on them in faith. God is here right now. God, from this place right here, we dispatch angels to go to our backslidden family members, Lord. They are ministering spirits that can minister to the heirs of salvation. The gifts and the calling are without repentance. They're still your children. God, do a work in them even now as we pray. If we have any intercessors in the house of God, I wonder if you can begin to intercede and stand in the gap. You don't even know perhaps what you're praying for, but let the Spirit pray through you. Is there anything too hard for our God? Is anything too hard for the Lord? God wants somebody to believe again. God wants somebody to have faith again. Come on, somebody fight for your faith. Contend for your faith. Stand up one more time and push back against the enemy and refuse to accept his report. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. God's not finished in this moment. Just keep on praying. But this declaration of God's ability interrupts a statement by Paul. It's bookended on either side when Paul said, "Now unto him be glory." And one more time, I believe that God has heard our prayer, but I wonder if we can seal the things we've prayed about, the impossibilities we've laid at his feet now. I wonder if we can fulfill this verse and let this verse come to fruition, and now unto him give all glory to the great God that we serve. I wonder if you can lift up a shout of faith and victory. Let it be a declaration that you still believe in a God that can do anything. Powerful revelation, but Paul put it in its proper context. It's a context of praise. Now unto him be all glory in the church. Church family, lift up a shout of praise, a shout of victory unto the Lord. I feel to do this. I know some of you have already stepped out on behalf of a family member that's not here, but I just feel prompted in the spirit. If you have somebody that, if that impossibility in your mind is a person, a husband, a wife, a son or a daughter, a mom or a dad, an aunt or an uncle, whatever, a close friend that is not here right now. Maybe they were here at one point, but they're not at this point. Or maybe they've never really made a step toward God. I believe that an impossibility shattering God is in this room tonight. And I believe, listen, you know, sometimes we say, well, God gave us free will, and he absolutely did. And ultimately the choice is theirs whether or not they're gonna serve the Lord. But if God can send plague after plague after plague after plague to bring a Pharaoh, an evil king, to the point of decision to allow God's will to be done, then don't you believe that God can allow circumstance after circumstance after circumstance to intersect the life of that person in order to bring them to a point of decision, in order to make the choice to serve God of their own free will? Listen, nothing is impossible for the God that we serve. Do you think that they are beyond the reach of your God? I wonder if in a step of faith and as a declaration of your belief in the ability of the God that you serve, I wonder if you can step right here to the front of this altar, and the rest of this church is going to gather around you, and we're going to lift up our wayward children. We're going to lift up cold and indifferent family members. Look at this. If the heart of a king is in the hand of God, don't you believe that the heart of your child is in the hand of the Lord? I believe that as we pray in this room tonight, that God can begin to work on our behalf and their behalf right now. Doesn't have to be a year or two from now. I believe God can begin to work right now. God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or think. Come on, your family member, that they just fit in the all category. But God can do so much more than just all. Come on, this is how you meet the enemy, Pastor Lehman. This is how you confront the enemy. You say, I refuse to take this report. I refuse to take this as it is. I'm going to stand in faith in the ability of what God can do. Hey, la basha ta ramondo yele la basa. The rest of you that are out in the auditorium, I invite you to come and find somebody to pray with, and let's believe God for the impossible together in the name of Jesus.